वेलकम स्टूडेंट्स, आई मिस्टर सिमांचल पंडा गोइंग टू स्टार्ट द क्लास फॉर सरफेस एंड इंटरफेसियल टेंशन पार्ट 3. लास्ट क्लास वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द डेफिनेशन ऑफ सरफेस टेंशन, इट्स टाइप, इट्स एप्लीकेशन, इट्स अ डिफरेंट मेथड ऑफ मेजरमेंट अबाउट द कैपिलरी राइज मेथड. टूडे वी विल गो फॉर इट्स एक्सप्लेनेशन. देयर आर डिफरेंट मेथड्स by which we can measure the surface tension. The first method is known as capillary rise method. Second one is known as dew noise tensiometer or ring tensiometer method. Third one is drop weight method, that is also known as the stalagmometer. The choice of method for measuring surface and interfacial tension depend on whether surface or interfacial tension is to be determined, the accuracy desired, and size of the sample. In the last class, we just went for the diagrammatic representation. Here, I told that if the capillary is having the radius of R and the diameter is 2R, then it will raise the molecules to up to certain extent due to its adhesive force. And the adhesive force, it will be neutralized with the gravitational force. Otherwise, we can tell that whenever there will be equilibrium between the force upward to the force downward, it will be the force, the work done has to be compared. Here, whenever the molecules are moving to upward, it will make certain angle, that is the theta. And the theta angle is denoted by theta here, radius is denoted by R. Whereas the height up to which it will move is noted by small h. The capillary rise occur because of upward force due to surface tension. Upward movement stop when its force is counterbalanced by the downward force due to weight of the capillary column. As I told, if the angle of contact is theta, then the resolution of vector for the gamma, that is the gamma cos theta. So we know that at a particular point the upward force is gamma cos theta. So if there is radius is R, the circumference will be 2 pi R. So at one point the force is gamma cos theta, so in the total circumference the force upward is 2 pi R into gamma cos theta. So again we will see that the height, if the height is h and the downward force can be written as 2 pi r square h, we can see that the weight of the column is mg and pi r square h, we can see the density difference rho minus rho 0 into g plus w. W is nothing but the weight. Here we can see if you are making a line parallel, so we can see it will have some amount of weight of the water will be there. So we have to add that amount of water along with the mg, that is nothing but the mass into gravity. So the mass can be written as pi r square h here, pi r square h, density rho minus rho 0, where density of liquid is rho and density of vapor is rho 0. So we are getting the total force, that is the moving downward, is pi r square h rho minus rho 0 g plus w. So we know that the vapor pressure density is very very less compared to the density of liquid, so we can neglect that term. And like in the previous equation we can see here pi r square h rho minus rho 0, so rho 0 can be neglected due to its low density, and W is also is negligible compared to the height. So water present here, that can be neglected. So pi r square h rho minus rho 0 g plus W will be converted to the equation like this. We can see here the rho 0 will be neglected, W is very small, so we are also neglecting this term. So therefore the downward force due to the weight of the column will be pi r square h rho g. So here we can see upward force is equal to downward force. The upward force we got here, see here the upward force is 2 pi r gamma cos theta, here 2 pi r gamma cos theta, and pi r square rho g will be the total downward force, as rho 0 and w are neglected and the terms are not in the equation. See here, right now 2 pi r gamma cos theta is the total upward forces and is the total downward forces. So by comparing the equation, we can get gamma is equal to r h rho g divided by 2 cos theta. Here we can see gamma, r is the radius, h is the height, rho is the density, g is the acceleration due to gravity. Here in the previous equation we can see this is the height, this is radius, this is the theta angle, and this is the density. So we are getting the equation r h rho g divided by 2 cos theta. So in case of water, that is taken as 0 because we can see the angle of contact is also very small and this can be also neglected, so it is becoming the 0. So cos 0 is equal to 1. So we can get 1 by 2 r h rho g is the final equation for the surface tension. Gamma is equal to 1 by 2 r h rho g. So here we have explained that in the previous one, this is the capillary. Whenever we make contact due to the surface tension, the water moves from the down to upside, and after a particular time we can see that it will be in the equilibrium. The equilibrium is maintained by the surface tension of the liquid, and whenever the downward force, that is acceleration due to gravity, will work on it, it will be balanced and it will remain at a particular level. So the point at which the surface tension will be equivalent to the downward force, it will be balanced. So total upward force, here we can see the total upward force at the equilibrium is equal to total downward force. So as in the previous equation we studied that the circumference is 2 pi r if the radius is r, and a particular point, we saw that at a particular point, see here, at a particular point if we are resoluting the vector, we can see that gamma cos theta, this is the gamma cos the one point, that one, the force, upward force is gamma cos theta. So for 2 pi r circumference, it will be 2 pi r gamma cos theta. Similarly, the mg we have calculated here, we can see here this mg calculations was there. So this was written by mass is nothing but pi r square h rho minus rho 0 into g. We calculated rho 0 as the density of the vapor that can be neglected, along with the weight, which is outside the circumference having certain angle, is also having the very less amount of weight. So we neglected the both term. So we got that pi r 2 h rho g. So from that we found the equation gamma is equal to r h rho g divided by 2 cos theta, or 1 by 2 r h rho g cos theta. So theta is very small and we have taken as the it as the 0. So we got the equation as the cos theta is equal to 1. So 1 by 2 r h rho g is the formula for surface tension. So for that there must be few precautions that we have to take. The first one is the outer vessel should have larger diameter, the capillary tube should have uniform diameter throughout its length, the height of the column should measure accurately, temperature must be maintained uniform, better to allow meniscus to fall down than allow to rise. We have seen here the outer vessel should be have larger diameter, that indicate that if you are taking any vessels which is having the more area, this area must be the ground area must have the more diameter compared to the capillary, otherwise the capillary cannot raise the liquid to upside. The second one, it is noted that capillary tube should have uniform diameter throughout its length. You can see here this is the cylinder, and if there will be change in the diameter or change in the radius, we can see we cannot get the same as the meniscus, and the calculation will vary. As the diameter will vary, the area wherever we are going for the calculation of the circumference will also vary. So next point was that height of the column should measure accurately, because the meniscus or this capillary is a very small diameter. If you are not making measuring it accurately, we cannot get the height. At a very small difference, we can have the calculation to be get varied more. So next point was that the temperature must be maintained uniform, because if the liquids sometime change in their density due to the moisture content, if the temperature will be More we can see that we have neglected the term here, that is the vapor pressure here, that is the density of the vapor, that will also vary and we cannot get the exact calculations. Better to allow meniscus to fall down instead of to rise, because we have to equilibrate the equation from the upward force to downward force. So always we have to maintain that the meniscus must be settled at a particular height instead of rising. The another method is known as the maximum bubble pressure method. Here we can see that the mercury is allowed to flow through each capillary. Here we can see the mercury. This mercury reservoir is allowed to move through the two different tubes. One is having the narrow capillary tube, another one is the wider capillary tube. So when the radius of narrow capillary is less than 0.01 centimeter, we can say 0.01 centimeter, that is the radius R1, and the wider is greater than 0.2 centimeter, that is the R2. The surface tension is given by the equation gamma is equal to AP 1 plus 0.67 R2G dP, where A is nothing but the instrument constant and D is the liquid density, P is the difference in pressure. By this method, we can also measure the surface tension. The another method is known as drop method. A drop method, we can see here that whenever the liquid is allowed to pass through a particular level, we can see that when the surface tension will be higher at a particular point, then the surface tension between the solid and the surface and the liquid, then the droplet will fall down. When a liquid is allowed to flow through a capillary tube, it forms a drop. At the tip of the tube, it increases its size. We can see that at the tip, it will start to increase its size. So whenever the size will have some more weight, at the time, it will start to detach. So we have to weight the drop just equal to the surface tension at the circumference. So W can be calculated by 2 pi R gamma divide, so that we can get gamma is equal to weight by 2 pi R. That is a simple method. We are taking the capillaries and we are allowing to move it slowly. We can see that due to the surface tension, the liquid will form a droplet and it will hang. So due to the surface tension, it will adhere against the gravitational force. So whenever the gravitational force will be increased due to the increase in its weight, we can see that at a particular point, it will start to detach from the capillary tube, because here the acceleration due or the downward force is equivalent to the surface tension. So we can measure the weight, and from that weight we can calculate the surface tension. The W is equal to 2 pi r gamma, as we have calculated earlier. So gamma is equal to, we can get from the equation as a W by 2 r gamma, gamma is equal to W by 2 pi r. So from that equation we can calculate easily the that surface tension. We can get the weight here, then we know the value of R, that is nothing but the radius of this capillary. Now this is the stalagmometer. We can see here, this is the stalagmometer here. It is having the both point A and B. So there is two method, that is first one is the drop weight, second one is known as the drop count method. So in the drop weight method, first we have to suck the liquid up to the mark A. Then here we can see we have to take the liquid up to the mark A and allow the liquid to drop from tip to the stalagmometer. We have to see here, we have to raise this one up to A, then after we have to drop it slowly. So we have to collect 20 to 30 drops and find out the weight and find the average weight of the drops. As we know the equation, gamma is equal to W by 2 pi r. So from that we can calculate the average weight drop, and the equation we can get it, that is the gamma 1 by gamma W is equal to W1 by WW, that is nothing but the weight of water and drop weight of this droplet. So here is a simple method. First we have to take the liquid, we have to suck up to the mark A, then after we allow it to move down. So how many drops are there, we can calculate the number of drops, or we can weight the number of drops, and from that we can calculate by applying the formulas, and we can calculate the surface tension from this. So this is the formula for it. Next one is the drop count method. In the drop count method, we can see that suck the liquid up to the mark A, then we allow the liquid to drop from tip of the stalagmometer. The count the number of drops formed till the liquid reach mark B. Gamma is equal to W by 2 pi Rn. N is the number of drops, W is the weight of total drops, D is the density, and the relative surface tension with respect to water is found from the equation gamma 1 divided by gamma W is equal to D1 Nw divided by dW N1. So we are comparing the two reference liquid. First one is the water, second one is the unknown sample, and from that we are just going on calculating the number of drops and the weight, and the weight and the drop will be calculated, and mg is equal to vdg is the formula, and from there we can calculate the density, and from the density we can find out the equation is that pi the gamma is equal to w by 2 pi rn, and we follow that equation gamma 1 divided by gamma w, and we will calculate the density, that is the surface tension. For this experiment we have to take certain precautions. Those are nothing but tip of the pipette should have no imperfection in the outer circumference. As we told that here generally it is having very small droplet area, so whenever we are consuming the liquid we can see that if the aperture will vary, if you are taking one stalagmometer for the water, another for the unknown liquid, the number of drops will vary. So we can vary the surface tension. The second point is that drops would be formed slowly. Sometime what happen, if we are keeping our hand, we are closing this one, so there is some non-uniform flow because due to the pressure difference. So we have to manage that the liquid has to move slowly instead of running fastly. Second one, the 20 to 30 droplets should be collected to find out average weight. The temperature should be maintained constant. The second one is known as ring detachment method. So the torsion balance or the Dunio balance consists of a platinum ring of around 4 cm in circumference, suspended on a torsion wire attached to a scale. The liquid is taken in a pan, or position of pan is adjusted so that the ring just touches the liquid. The torsion wire is rotated till the ring just detaches from the surface of the liquid. Force required to detach the ring from the surface is obtained from the scale. The force is proportional to the surface tension. It is a very easiest method that there is actually the reading there and we are applying the pressure. So whenever we can see that it will just try to move, the point at which the torsion wire attached to a scale, the liquid pan position of a just it will be rotated and detached from the surface of the liquid. The force required will be calculated and the surface tension can easily be determined. This one is the liquid container. The force applied here, so whenever it is moving at a particular point it will be detached, and the detached point will be here from the tensiometer it is having the reading, and from the reading it can be easily determined. So the formula applied here, P is equal to 2 pi R1 plus R2 gamma, gamma is equal to P divided by R pi R1 plus R2. R1 and R2 are nothing but the inner and outside radius of the ring. Gamma is equal to P by 4 pi R if R1 and R2 is equal to 1. So there are also different precautions are taken. The ring should be in the, it will lie in the flat plane. The plane of the ring must be horizontal. The vessel containing the liquid should have the wider diameter, and the temperature must be remained constant. So there are different type of the parameters which are concerned with the surface. As we know that if the surface tension will be reduced, then the solubility will increase. So a surfactant molecule is depicted systematically here. We can see that one is having the polar end and it is having the non-polar tail. So generally these are the hydrocarbon chains which are having the tail part, and these are having the lipophilic in nature and these are having the polar nature. So generally it will have the both compatibility with polar and this is the polar solvent and the non-polar solvent. So it will help to solubilize different type of the material. These are also used as a surface active agent, wetting agent. So we can see here a surfactant molecule is depicted schematically, a cylindrical representing the hydrocarbon, that is the hydrophobic portion, this is the hydrophobic portion, with sphere representing the polar, that is the polar group here attached to one end. The hydrocarbon chain are straight because the rotation around the carbon-carbon band coils twist them. So one example is sodium lauryl. You can see here, this is the example, and this is generally used to reduce the surface tension. Anything that reduces the surface tension is known as the surfactant. The molecules and ions, those are absorbed at the interface, are termed surface active agent. The surfactant or the amphiphile, the molecule or the ion has a certain affinity for both polar and non-polar solvents. Depending upon the number and nature of the polar and non-polar groups present, the amphiphilic may be hydrophilic, lipophilic, or resorbable, well absorbed between the two extremes. The amphiphilic nature of surface active agent, which causes them to be absorbed at the interface, whether this is to be liquid or gas or liquid or liquid. So generally, the surface active agents are having two parts. One is the hydrophilic, second one is the lipophilic. So these are calculated by a particular instrument is known as the hydrophilic lipophilic balance, and from that we can determine which one is the wetting agent and what is the foaming agent. Different type of the ingredient can be determined under the range. So according to the pharmaceutical use, the surfactant can be divided in as the wetting agent, solubilizing agent, emulsifying agent, dispersing, suspending or deflocculating agent, foaming and anti-foaming agent or detergents. So these are the total different varieties of surfactant or use of surface tension. As any substance that will reduce the surface tension is known as the surfactant. Those are generally used in the suspension as the suspending agent. If those are coming for the emulsion, those are the emulsifying agent. And different type of wetting agent, foaming agent, anti-foaming agent, depending upon the HLBSK, they are categorized. So today we have studied about all those things. The first started from the capillarized method. Then we studied about the Dunois tensiometer. We studied the calculation, the maximum bulk pressure method, the drop method, that stalagmometer. Then after ring detachment method, and we studied about the different category of surface active agent. So now for today we have completed the surface tension chapter, and in the next we will study with a new chapter. Thank you.